యూట్యూబ్ లింక్ ప్రెస్ చేసి చూడు ఏమవుతుంది. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. People, folks online and people present here, welcome once again for the demo day of Road to Shine program. We had our 4 months of journey nurturing innovators from their ideas to an implementation stage where now they're going to present you with top 8 ideas. We had around 20 participants, and out of them, we've selected 8 of them. And today we are very proud and very excited to listen and see how they have come far from the journey, just from the idea till implementation. Welcome again, everyone. Let's start. So I have a very special guest today from Government of Telangana to give keynote. I would like to welcome Mr. Gopal Krishnan, Director of Automotive, Government of Telangana. Thank you.
This is okay for you?
Thank you, Priyanka. So, okay. It's a new norm. Respected Governor of Hiroshima Prefecture, Mr. Yuzaki Hidehinko. Ms. Naho, Director, Mr. Srikant from Amazon, friends from T-Hub, and participants, ladies and gentlemen. First, let me thank T-Hub for giving me this opportunity, for giving this floor to address you all in this very... So, innovation at local level and knowledge sharing and global collaboration is the driving engine of today's science. India and Japan, we have a lot of inherent strengths. India, on one hand, has a diverse population, has a good natural resource base and a huge consumer market. Japan, on the other hand, has cost competitiveness, a lot of attraction for investors, ease of doing business, advanced technology and infrastructure, and a very good workforce. Businesses globally can benefit from the collaboration between India and Japan. So over the last few years, I would say recent times, there has been a really good partnership between India and Japan. And this is mainly due to the strong efforts from both the governments. Economically, the partnership economically is one of the most important cornerstone of our engagements, which has resulted in Japan being the fourth most or highest investment partner to India, the fourth highest. I'm really happy to see that T-Hub is working with Hiroshima Prefecture on this initiative and strengthening the bonds between Telangana and Japan, and also taking forward such a good digital transformation kind of a thing, human-centric approach. So let me also delve a little bit on today's topic, which is the necessity or the focus shift from normal digital technology to, you know, building a normal digital technology to bringing a human-centric approach to it. So crisis can happen at any time, anywhere, but normally we human beings, we come out of it, we try to make the better of it always, we adapt. Even right now, COVID-19, it has hit mankind badly. There has been a lot of radical changes that is happening on our day-to-day lives. We do a lot of online interaction. We don't step out of our house. We try to buy things online, groceries, be it vegetables or fruits. We don't go and attend classes in universities or colleges. We take online classes. Also, another example would be this event where we have a limited physical presence, but also online viewership. Also, we've started working from home a lot, which is a new norm and which is not an option, but actually a norm right now. So there are all these things, a lot of it is going to stay. So during these turbulent times, during rapid changing times, all the innovators, they think, what do I do next? How do I innovate? How do I build products and services which will cater to the needs of this ever-changing or the new landscape that is coming up into the picture because of such crisis, which is unforeseen. So this is where human-centric approach helps you. So let me talk a little bit about this approach. So in any digital transformation, there are three key elements. One is people, business, and technology. So normally, most often than not, it would be heavy technology-led innovation or software platform, which would actually get to the way of the people who are who matter the most. Unfortunately, the software part of it would be taken care of, but not the people-centric part. So that is where this end-user-centric approach helps you. And it also saves a lot of cost, time, and rework, which would otherwise be required if you don't go by that approach during the design and development phase. And how do you go about engaging yourself for this approach? You have to understand your end user, you have to understand the context, and you have to work on the cost and time from the viewpoint of the end user and give him a good strategy or onboarding strategy so that things fall in place. So this has to be done from the design phase itself through different phase gates. You keep thinking about the end user. So before I end, before I close, let me tell you something which a good friend of mine told me a couple of days back. He said that ideas inherently are not classified or categorized as good or bad. They are not more important or less important. So you have ideas, there are problems to solve, and some of these ideas solve those problems. And there are governments or local bodies that actually scout for solutions for big problems. So when you have the intersection of an idea solving a problem, which was actually required by local bodies or governments, at that intersection, that is where an idea becomes important or good. But every idea is equally important. So I understand that I think six of you have reached to this final stage after multiple rounds of reviews, and three of you are going to see your idea get implemented going forward. To the other three, as well as to those who couldn't make it, please keep at it, put your efforts on a daily basis, be consistent, and who knows, you might reach that intersection sooner because of putting your effort on a daily basis. And your ideas today are going to run nations tomorrow. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Gopal. Now I would like to run through the flow of today's event. So each, this is our agenda today. So we'll have break around 11:10 a.m. Before that, we will have four presenters. Each will get 8 minutes as indicated to you in our communication. And 3 minutes will be for the feedback or comment that you will get from the mentors or the evaluators that are there on the forum. So please remember that 8 minutes, we will be timing out for 8 minutes, all the presenters. Then post break, we'll have four other participants giving their presentation. Then again, we'll have a 10 minutes break. And post that break, we'll have a certificate ceremony and we'll announce the participants with the closure remarks. So this would be our flow for today. Please, again, all the participants, please note that you have 8 minutes of time to present your idea to all the evaluators and the audience. With this, I would like to welcome one of our enthusiastic mentor who has been mentoring our participants right from day one. We have Srikant here. Srikant is he has worked in Amazon with 17 years of experience, and he has been part of the program, and most of you must have interacted with him. With this brief note, I would like to welcome Srikant on the floor.
Hey, hello, good morning, everyone. Good morning, everybody on the net. It's a great day. I think this is the first time I think I'm really stepping out to a crowded place, frankly. It's nice to see. I mean, I have interacted with most of you guys and girls, and I think the enthusiasm is amazing, right? I mean, the kind of ideas that people are coming up with, the passion that they have to really solve, take a problem heads on and find solution is mind-boggling, right? I just wish that, you know, just one suggestion that I would like to give is always for human-centric design, you have to step out of your idea, of your company, and you have to step in the shoes of your end customers. You have to think that, okay, I am the person who needs this. And then start thinking, okay, how can I expect, what are my expectations out of this service that this company ABC is going to offer me? And given my limitations, I may be uneducated, I may be handicapped, I may be blind, I may be, you know, whatever, I mean, some other problems, or financially not good, I may not be able to afford it. Still, is there something for me? Is there a small bit of it that can help me in solving some of my problems? So that is, I think, the key towards a human-centric design, that you have to really consider the last man standing in the line, right? And you have to build something. You may not be able to, your product may not fit, you know, somebody who's earning below a threshold of income, but at least something you have to give it to him, right? So that makes it human-centric, that you have to consider variety of customers and you have to really solve for them, right? And the world is diverse. It's so, you know, not every two people are same, right? In terms of their mindset, how they think, the expectation of the quality of service, the kind of service that they provide you, that they expect from the service provider. So you have to really, you know, see what, how can you, you know, cater to the large audience, right? And really you have to empathize. Like when you talk of human-centric stuff, you have to put people and profits at the same priority level, right? So that's what I think human-centric design is all about. And And especially in cities, right? Cities is a very complex ecosystem. It's so much intricate. The things are so much interconnected that if you really want to solve, like, for example, there was an idea of an ambulance service, right? Now, ambulance services depend on infrastructure, traffic. Things are not in your control. You cannot say that, okay, because I want to provide less than 30 seconds or less than 1 minute of ambulance service, I'm going to solve the traffic problems. You're dependent on that. So you have to work around that and see if you can find something in the given limited resources, the limited environment, the constraints that you are living in today, how can you provide the service in a better fashion? So I think those are some aspects that, you know, people need to consider. And thank you for calling me here, and happy to, you know, interact with more entrepreneurs who are really passionate to solve everyday problems. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Srikant, for those wonderful words. Now I would like to welcome Naho-san to give a brief introduction about the program and also about talk a few words about the second phase of the Hiroshima part. Yeah.
Yeah, good morning, everybody. So today, this is the final day for phase one. So at first, we invited more than 700 people for the application. And after then, so almost 20 people, well, 20 teams are here. And then today, we squeeze down for the presentation to the 8 teams. And finally, we'll select 3 teams. And initially, what we are thinking is we wanted to send these kinds of the finalists to Hiroshima, Japan. But unfortunately, so because of the COVID, so myself, I cannot go back to Japan. Yeah. So even the Christmas, even New Year, I'll stay here. And maybe in another 1 year, I need to stay here. But somehow, as a second phase, we want to create the opportunity to work with the actual Hiroshima company. Yeah, because in the when we started in these kind of programs, what we are thinking is, so in Japan, and of course, we created the slightly bigger economy, but still, we Japan, we have a lot of the problems. Of course, I know India, we also have the problems. Yeah, but somehow, so on the both of the side, and we have the problems, but we need to solve these kind of the problems. And in my past experience, so to combine different types of the people is a very good way to create the innovations. So sometimes we can say diversity, and sometimes the different culture or something. Yeah, so that's what I believe is to combine Indian people and Japanese people, so that it can create the very good, very strong teams. Yeah, so this is a very big concept for us. So on the phase two, so we have done the 3 Hiroshima companies, and they are in the different sectors. So one is for the digital. So they are doing the analyzing, analytics, and for the automotives or something, yeah. And one is in the package company, but they want to create in the ideal packaging solution for the maybe next the midterms or so. So one is in the logistics association and from the regions. So well, we will create in the teams, one from India, one from Hiroshima. And our expectation is in the how we can think about the new idea for the service or new business or some kinds of the solutions. Yeah. And so once in the we select in the three teams, so we will make in the one each of the teams. And first, we'll understand each other's. So what is the problems? So what is happening for in India or so? So then, so start the discussion and what kind of the solution so that we can think about and for Hiroshima company. And then so we are going to create a prototype if possible. So that is the second phase two. So we are going to start in the phase two and later in Jan till the end of the February. Yeah, so hopefully, so now we can see some kinds of the good, the solution, and after February. Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you, Nahasan, for that. Now we have a special guest who's going to talk to you and give you a brief. That's none other than our Hiroshima Garner, Mr. Izaki. This is a message from beyond, guys. Can we play the video?
Innovations from the future and inspires people from all around the world. For those of you who will be a part of this effort, I look forward to meeting you in Hiroshima soon.
So let's start the most interesting part now. With that, I would like to welcome Team Anokriya. Can you move on to the next slide? Yeah, we have Team Anokriya online. Online we have Asad Ahmed, Faizan Ali, and Meet Shah. Guys, over to you. Please unmute yourself and start. We hope we have 8 minutes of time.
Okay, am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Hi, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank R2S for providing us this great opportunity to be presenting in front of all you guys. So we like to start a presentation now. Next slide, please. So our idea is basically decentralized task training and jobs. Next slide, please. So first of all, I'd like to talk about how and why we came up with this idea. So we have been part of an NGO called Ashai Charitable Trust, which is a registered trust in Mumbai. We've been a part of it for more than 10 years now. And we've always looked for ways to apply what we've learned to help the people in need. So we used to visit old age homes or people with disability or women empowerment NGOs, and we try to think of ways in what we can help them other than the ways that we're already helping them.
Boss, can you just repeat the name of the NGO? I could not hear you properly.
Ashai Charitable Trust. Ashai Charitable. It's written in the slide also if you want the spelling.
Okay, please continue.
Okay, sure. So once when we visited NGO called Bombay Institute of Deaf and Mutes, we realized that they were looking to be self-sustainable. They wanted jobs to sustain themselves. And when COVID started, we saw that a lot of jobs shifted and there was decentralization. So we got to thinking how we could use this to their advantage and help them work from home. Next slide, please.
So with this background in mind, we started our Road to Shine journey. We identified our users as people who are deaf and mute and are in the age of 18 to 65, basically the working age, and they show a good aptitude towards computer. Next slide, please. The main context of why these people suffer or what their issues are is that they have a lot of societal and regional barriers, which makes them ineligible for jobs. They also lack higher degree of education and even vocabulary for a proper full functioning job, which makes the job market very limited. The pain that they suffer from is that they want to be self-sufficient. They want to be independent and rely on themselves and support their family. They also, given the current situation, they also have a all the current jobs have a minimum level of qualification that is required. So they are looking for places where they can work without any much qualification required and learn on the way. They also have some trouble in communicating and traveling, and which makes the entire process tedious. So our job that is from their work from home and they can work as their leisure time will be helpful. With this, we started our interview process. And Faiza, next slide, please.
So I searched for potential user for our platform leaders to different location at Mumbai, and one of which was the Bombay Institute of Deaf and Mute, where we met Mr. Vishal, 18-year-old youth, having the condition of speech and auditory impairment. Like any other, we too had this misconception that people of this sort are not capable to deal with complex technology such as computer. But thanks to R2S, while interviewing Mr. Vishal, our conception was cleared. To our surprise, people of this sort have very good cognitive and pattern recognition skill and can easily work with computer-driven tasks. And they are constantly looking for job opportunities that could be more than just menial data entry job. Next slide, please. Next, we interviewed our product manager of a startup on chatbot. According to her, if there is cost effectiveness and accuracy is at par along with the quality assurance and good customer experience, they are ready to outsource their any data annotation task to any startup. Next slide, please.
So with this insight in mind that they're looking for a smoother onboarding process, training on the job, and also proper job with proper customer satisfaction, we came up with a platform called Anapriya. So it is a simple get paid as you work platform which provides training, a simple onboarding to anyone who wants to work on the platform. It also provides simple human intelligence tasks which anyone can provide. We also have automated quality assurance in place which makes it faster for us to deliver credits on basis of the performance of the users. A simple snapshot of the platform is here. As in Anokriya, we like to say that even if you have any barriers, don't worry, you will be able to still do it. Next slide, please. So it sounds simple, right? But how is it actually working? So if any employee or user wants to work on the platform, they have to go through a simple registration process. Upon registration, they are transferred to our e-training platform, where they go through a simple or sequential task using positive reinforcement, visual clues, and live feedback. They get to know and they get to train better on performing tasks. After e-training, the employee gets verified. Upon verification, the task is very simple. They will be getting a bunch of tasks on a daily basis. Upon performing the task, the output of the task is transferred to our servers, where we do automated quality assurance. And upon measuring the quality at par, as far as customer satisfaction is required, we credit the credits to the employees. And upon crediting the credits, the employees can directly cash out using our payment gateways. Next slide, please.
So what makes us unique? How are we different from the people who are already helping the deaf and mute? So in general, when we interview the people in NGOs, they generally try to provide the basic needs for these people, like shelter, food, clothing, and the basic amount of education. But they still struggle in creating job opportunities on a larger scale. So we try to bring that thought into action. And also our platform isn't specific for deaf and mutes. It can be generalized for other users like homemakers or retired professionals and differently abled people. In general, anyone who wants to have flexible working hours and can work from home. Next slide, please. So our services can be human intelligence tasks in the field of data annotation or data creation in computer vision, natural language processing, and audio processing. Since we are engineers, we came up with machine learning based tasks, but the task can be anything that can be done from home and can be decentralized. Next slide, please. So we have six value propositions to provide for the companies: cost effective, cheap service, schedule or deadline flexibility, very flexible workforce, automated quality assurance checks using statistical models and backend, feedback loops by connecting customers to employees so that customer has a transparent view of what is happening with their data, and minimum at par accuracy by distributed working. Next slide, please.
And finally, this is our prototype for the current platform, which is capable of performing simple data annotation tasks such as bounding boxes. As you can see on the top right side, there is a task description section where the task which is to be done by the user is described, the language of which can be changed according to the user's language preference. And can you like replay? Yeah, thank you. On the left-hand side, as you can see, there are multiple toolboxes. And going by the data creating boxes example, we choose the make box option and then click on the specified object on the image and drag the cursor to create the box and then do some basic adjustment like replacing the boxes and readjusting its corner. And after the task is complete, the user will send the data to the server after clicking on the next button on top right corner. And after that, user can either continue doing the task or get out of the platform. So with that, our presentation ends here. Thank you so much for providing us this opportunity. I hope you like it.
Hello. Thank you, team. Anyone has any questions, comments? Shimuga-san?
Thank you to the team for the presentation. I see that you've worked on it because earlier the video was quite fast, but this time I think your presentation was well considered and it was really easy to digest and listen to. I love the fact that you made the actual application and the demonstration for us. It was really easy and clear to understand what you're trying to provide. And I see that it brings a lot of opportunities now that this whole industry is booming and expanding. So I think you have a very good like mid to long term shot that actually would serve, may create more jobs and give opportunities to the much wider type of sort of workers. One thing which would be even nicer if you could have worked on it was you mentioned about the self-sufficiency and independence. And I think you had such a wide range of possible target users, but I think there are more people that is critical to have this type of self-sufficiency and independence. And this is just from the Japan context, but thinking about some of the successful services here, a lot of the people, especially the parents of the people who have some kind of a disabilities, tend to long for this type of services. So they feel like they can sort of let those children to have more independencies and being self-sufficient. Rather than always being on their back and then, being too mindful and watchful for them. They also want to sort of give their children more opportunities to be free and independent. So I wonder if it would have, what would be the case if you could sort of think or focus a little bit more on the sort of like a younger generation who has much longer period of life ahead. And what if they feel more confident and feel like there's a lot more opportunity for them waiting for in sort of next decades or so. So it could be nice. What my sort of recommendation is like, regardless of not just thinking this as the end of your journey, but if you could sort of explore this type of younger generation and perhaps even their parents and to see how they respond to this type of services and whether they could be even more passionate and excited about this opportunity. It would be nice to have those kind of feedback so that your services can be even matured further. And thank you for the presentation.
Sure, thank you so much.
So you have, okay. Srikanth has one comment for you.
Yeah, so great presentation. Just had a couple of points that I observed. So for cost cutting, right? I mean, if you have to be competitive, to competitors, you have to make sure that you provide the service at low cost. But I just humbly request you not to compromise the wages, minimum wages of the people who are working, because that would be discriminatory, right? I mean, if you are going to pay X amount to an able body person, you should pay the same amount to, you know, non-able. You have to cut corners elsewhere. You have to figure out how to optimize your operations. Secondly, you haven't considered other disabled people like blind and transgenders. I mean, transgender is not a disability, but still they are discriminated in our society, right? So these kind of things, you can expand the scope a little bit to include transgenders. And for blind people, obviously the same application, the same task they cannot perform, but there are other tasks like, you know, accessibility testers, right? If you have apps, there are so many apps. Right. How do we know that they are accessibly, they're blind friendly? So there has to be a fleet of people who are actually testing it and sharing their feedback to the developers so that they can improve upon that. And obviously you'll have to add multilingual, like all the 25, 26 languages in India, you have to add. And for people who are mute and cannot read, are not educated, you probably have to have some kind of voice kind of feedback. Like the task description could be like the accessibility. I mean, you also have to think about how do you make your site accessible for, you know, people who cannot read, write, and have certain limitations, right? Obviously, we cannot solve that for deaf people to using voice, but, you know, you have to think on those. So these are the things that, you know, are my feedback to you. Thank you. Congratulations.
Thank you so much for your comment.
Thank you. We have our next team here at T-Hub, Team Phoenix. I welcome Pratyusha, Teja, and Harikishore on the floor.
Good morning, respected dignitaries and my dear friends. My name is Seja, she is Pratyusha, and he is Harikishore. And our topic is regarding e-waste. Next slide. Yeah, let's start e-cycling. Let's start our session. Next slide, please. Let's start our session with a common interaction question that how many of us have old, unused electronics at our homes? Please try to respond. Yeah, probably everyone. Okay, can you name them, please? Like, whatever it may be. Okay. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Old, outdated DVD players and...
Yeah, yes, sir. Yes. Yeah, exactly. So it will be the same situation with almost every one of us. We'll be having old unused electronics like mobile phones, earphones, old laptops like that. But the question is, what are we going to do with that once they're completely used? Have we ever thought of that? No, right? I mean, what we'll be doing once they're completely used, right? Like some of us may be simply throwing in dustbin. Like some of us will be exchanging with some other gadgets or simply kept aside in our homes, right? But it's not the proper way of dealing that e-waste, right? Because it has its own consequences once they are not cared of, once we are not concerned about them, right? So it has its own consequences, and that will be discussed by my friend Harikishore.
Next slide, please. Yeah, next one. So my name is Harikishore, as Teja has introduced me. So as by previous interaction session, we have been, it's pretty clear that most of us have unused electronics. So the thing is, our idea, we first had certain kind of idea in our mind. And so we wanted to make it, make use of this, some particular sector of electronics. Means most people will have DVD players, and that is a one of the most major electronics. And others will have old mobile phones, and some others will have the tube TVs, vacuum tube TVs. It will be this much big. So, but all from all this ocean of e-waste, we are going to deal with some particular type of e-waste. That's what we thought. And so our idea was to refurbish those products and resell them into the market. Next slide, please. Yeah. Okay. Fine. That's what we wanted to do. So by statistics, we found that the e-waste has been increasing exponentially, which is seen here. So based on these statistics, we wanted to reduce this e-waste. So first we wanted to go to refurbishment. That was our main idea. We put that, placing that idea in our mind, we wanted to start our user researches and user interviews. So first, I'll try to explain the idea which was in our mind in the beginning before user interviews. Next slide, please. Yeah, our idea is pretty simple. Thing is, because of this COVID pandemic, everything has become online, right? So since we need e-goods such as mobiles, tablets, laptops, because these three goods can be used for interaction online, and things can be done such as classes and Zoom meetings, etc., will be performed, right? So, but not everyone can afford 2 to 3 mobiles in their home, and because 2 to 3 mobiles are necessary, because one mobile phone or one laptop will be used for the father, and if there are 2 to 3 children, they need this for their schooling and their education purposes. But let's take a scenario where the father can only afford only one new gadget, and the other might not be he may not be able to afford that. So we thought of taking that case, and we tried to make an affordable way to buy these refurbished goods, and we thought of going statistics. That was our initial idea. But after taking user interviews, it's a bit changed. We didn't expect what happened, and that will be covered by Pratyusha. Thank you.
Yeah, next slide, please. Yeah, meet Mr. Potana. He works at BNR VJIT College. Basically, we consider him as our middle class father, who is our user particularly. And then we went to him and asked him how was this pandemic and whether he needed gadgets or not. He told that I required almost 2 to 3 gadgets, which are to be bought in this pandemic, especially to continue online. Then we have asked him if we can be able to reduce the cost. He said, oh, that's great. Then we told him refurbished goods are there, which can be quite affordable compared to new ones. Then his response was no, I don't want to buy refurbished. What may be the issue? That's because that's majorly the trust issue. Generally, people don't buy refurbished or secondhand goods because of the trust in life and maintenance issues, right? Even this was the case with him. Apart from him, we have also interviewed almost 5 to 6 other fathers who required this kind of mobile phones and all. Even they told the same, they really don't want refurbished products. Then what was the case? Then we have started to talk with them regarding this e-waste and all. Next slide, please. Okay, now users are not ready to buy the refurbished products which we are going to offer. Now what to do? Then why go for them? Then after talking to users and regarding everything, then we came to know that we are having e-waste, like unused mobile phones, which we want to deliver as some kind of refurbished goods, but users are not ready to accept them. Now the major point is, we thought this is not the problem. The users are facing another problem, like when they have e-waste at home, they really don't know what to do with them or how to handle them. This is the major observation we have done. This is, I would say, some breakthrough point in our user research, that around 90% of the users, electronic gadgets users, really don't know how to handle them or dispose them after their usage. Next slide, please. Yeah. Then we came up with this idea called e-waste to e-treasure. What we thought of doing is we will collect that e-waste. Like generally, why people are not aware? Because they might not have seen those advertisements, or you know, they just, what they do is if the mobile or some gadget is working to some extent, they'll go to some shop and they'll sell. If it's not working at all, or you know, some partially or replacement or repair cost is very high, then probably they'll not go to some local shop. Then definitely what they do is they just keep them aside. What we thought of taking them and, you know, we'll examine those goods, whether they can be refurbished or recycled. Okay, fine. If they cannot be further refurbished, we thought of handling them over to authorized recycler, you know, who handles them with the proper environmental concerns and all. Then next, what we thought is, once we collect the refurbished gadgets, we are going to sell it to the persons who are ready to take them. Like, not just some simple mobile phones, there can be some other perspective which we can use those unused mobile phones and all. Next slide, please. Yeah, coming to implementation. Initially, we will reach out to our users with the help of online platforms and through local media, because many people don't know what to do. Then once we'll provide them with our contact numbers and reach out address, once they find e-waste with them, we will give them a contact number. They will contact us. We'll send our technician to their house to collect the e-waste and examine, and it will be further processed. Now, after processing that and all, we are going to reward our users. And one more thing we want to do is, somehow this e-waste is handled illegally in most of the places. What we want to do is, we want to form a network chain of those raddiwalas, like whoever collect this e-waste and all, because that's the major step where it goes beyond the user's point. So what if we collect from them? I think even the people who, you know, sell it to that also, we can take it and make it quite good for the environment. Next slide, please. Yeah. Like I have previously said, what else can we do with those old mobile phones apart from using it as mobile? That will be handled by Harkisho.
So as we know, people are not preferring refurbished goods. That point has been established pretty well. So then what to do with them? What to do with them? As while we were going through these mentoring sessions and everything, ideas were pouring in, and one idea we tried it very good. Use mobile phones or laptops, but not with their original functionalities, but for some other things, such as let's use a mobile phone in the camera as a surveillance system. So that if people who want to buy a surveillance system, they don't think that, yes, we need a brand new surveillance system. No, what they want is, the needs is to be served. It has to be worked perfectly. The surveillance should be done clearly. And if anything goes wrong, it has to be intimated. What they need is these three things. Right? So what if we can make use of this cameras in the mobile phone and laptops to make that particular functionality possible? So that's where we thought of making the difference. So we'll take the e-waste from there. We'll collect it, and we'll see what are the usable parts of that, and other unusable will be recycled completely. And the things which are usable, will be converting it to another mode of operating devices, such as the surveillance system. And the other one is, most people have pets, right? So they for monitoring those pets, like as if they're hungry or any other functionality such as that, if the pet has gone missing, some pets will be missing or etc. like that. So for pet monitoring system, and the other can be done as baby monitoring system. It's like, all you have to do is make sure that few sensors and a camera is working right or not in those mobile phones and laptops, and we can make a good product out of it. In this way, we are not encouraging refurbishment, but we are encouraging some reusement of these products in a new way, so that we can make it a more environment friendly, and the users will also find it helpful for this. So this is what we wanted to do, apart from recycling or e-waste. Next slide, please. And with this, most people will have that we have e-waste, what to do. We'll be sharing our context. And I would like to know your views also. If you have any e-waste, we just want to help you. What to do with this? And further, I'm going on with how to make them useful. Next slide. Thank you. Please.
Thank you, team. Any comments from the crowd here?
Make one comment. So the idea of reusing an old mobile phone for other purposes, it's not as simple as you think. I mean, especially extracting. You said we'll extract the components that are usable, which are not usable, we'll recycle it. The new ones, we'll use it, repurpose it. All cameras have different, all phones have different cameras, different interfaces. It is difficult for you to build such a product, okay, which can cater to all sorts of cameras. So that technical aspect you have to consider here. It may not work out. You may use it if it is, at least let's say the display is not working. If the CPU is, it's booting up and it's working, then you can use it for some kind of decentralized cloud, you know? Like every phone has like what, 4 gigahertz of processing power, right? So even if you consider a quad core, 1 gigahertz for every core, you have 4 gigahertz, you have so much of RAM. I'm just waiting for somebody to really use this thing to create a data, a cloud or some kind of processing, you know, supercomputer, just connect millions of them and then make sure that, you know, you get that processing power. And then you can scale it up to people also. People can earn money from that. Like use Bitcoin, blockchain processing and let people earn money from, most of the time my phone is idle. There's four gigahertz of processing power in my pocket, in each of our pockets. Here itself, we have like almost like, a huge amount of processing capability, which we are not harnessing, right? So think in those lines. No, don't extracting, creating hardware, that's not going to happen. It's practically not possible. And also, I think the original problem that you suggested that we don't know what to do with our waste, but then you didn't give me a solution. Are you going to build a user-friendly website? You said you are going to promote yourself. Share your phone numbers. That's not how it works. People are used to Swiggy. They are used to deliver, getting on a click of a button, it should get delivered, right? So those are the problems that you should really think, like, how do we connect these e-waste, people who are holding this e-waste onto a platform? So you have to talk a bit more about that.
Actually, we want to reach out to the people by digital marketing. Like these days, we are using a lot, be it Instagram or Facebook or YouTube. Like we are reaching, okay. We want to reach out
that
to them.
That didn't come out in the presentation.
Like, yeah, exactly. Right? Okay,
cool. So that, and so that's the thing. So there are companies like in GitHub itself, there's one lady, right? E-waste exchange. Sanshodhan, right?
Exactly.
So they are leading in this efforts. Yes, so I hope you got a chance to talk to them.
Yes,
and refine your idea. But I think that the idea of reusing the product in a different way is a good insight.
Yes, sir.
But the application that you mentioned may not work out. Maybe there are some other applications.
Yes, actually, we would like to add some more IoT to the refurbished products. And then we want, it may be useful for some other things like that, as we mentioned earlier.
See if you can reuse it as it is without touching, getting, because that's a huge engineering cost.
Yes, sir.
Okay, because I thought he's mentioned that we will extract the components and then that's why I got a bit carried away. Okay, fine. Yeah,
yes.
Correct.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next, we have Tarun. Tarun, can you unmute yourself and start presenting?
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes.
All right. My name is Tarun and I'm a fourth year engineering student at NIT Agartala and I'm working on a mental health project. Next slide, please. So this is Chintu and during class 12th, he could not crack IIT JEE. Even though he studied very hard, he could not. And he went through a breakup at the same time. So these two life events resulted in depression. See, Chintu is my nickname and this is my life story. See, I am Chintu, but Chintu is not just me. In fact, anybody could be Chintu. Next slide, please. In India, 2.6 crore Indian youth are dealing with mental health issues. And Chintu represents all of them. The data is given by ICMR and the problem goes beyond this huge number because, next slide, please. 83% of these youth do not receive any support, and in medical terms, it is called as treatment gap. This is primarily because of reasons like high stigma, high costs of professional help, and of course, low mental health awareness. I thought, since many of us are dealing with mental health issues, I decided to build a platform to help them. Next slide, please. See, I built a platform in May 2020 where youth can get free and anonymous emotional support. We helped about around 700 youth in 4 months, and we saw a clear trend. Only 15% of our users are males and other 85% are females. So even if it is free and anonymous, still boys are not reaching out for help. And this insight came to us after using R2S user insights, that framework. And before that, our concept was using the platform and connecting users with trained peer counselors who are psychology students in their second year masters. So they are well equipped and they are mentored by psychologists, and they can provide good support to users, I mean quality support to youth. Next slide, please. So I started talking to boys who reached out to us for emotional support, and I spoke to a total of 21 boys. And I asked them, bro, did you speak about the problem with your friends or family? And the common reply was, no, I did not want to talk about my problems because I felt embarrassed and it may look like I'm attention seeking. And the most common answer was, I searched for apps, but I did not use apps with the words like mental health and depression because I don't want to feel like my condition is serious. And another common answer was, most self-help apps are boring because they are using mindfulness and meditation, and I don't want to do that. So all of our users are college students in the age of 18 to 22, and they're dealing with mild to moderate levels of stress, anxiety, and depression. Next slide, please. So I realized that what they need is a self-help solution where they don't feel like they're relying on others. And also, most boys thought that seeking support or talking about their problems made them look unmanly. Next slide, please. So with this insight, I thought I'll make a solution which is fun and engaging. This game is called Emotional Fitness Gym, and it is just like you go to a physical gym to build physical muscles. You can come to Emotional Fitness Gym and build resilience for dealing with mental health issues. So it's simple, right? A 10 minutes game workout a day keeps emotional problems away. Just like you do physical workouts, but the only difference is our game workouts are much more fun and engaging. Next slide, please. So we made a small prototype having these four things in our mind. The first thing was it should free the users from the feeling of unmanliness. So they should not feel like they're relying on someone for their support. And it should be engaging because most of the self-help apps online are boring because they're only focused on meditation, where you hear someone speak and you need to do that. You need to do something the person is speaking in a voice. And we not only solve these two pain points, which is lack of fun solution and lack of this stigmatized approach of if I go out and seek help, then I might look weak or I might look unmanly. We solve these two by making a self-help solution which is fun and engaging. But also we could also solve two more things. That is, these two are actually games where the game is always available. So even if you have emotional distress at late in night or early mornings, you can always use the game because it's online, it's on your phone. And we can make it much personalized because we can take data from your insights, as in maybe I'm dealing with this and I want to work on this, and this is how much time I'm sleeping, and these are the games that I like. So we're going to take feedback from that and make it more personalized so they feel it is engaging. And we did a small prototype to show all of these features. Next slide, please. So can you play that? So she's Siri, and she's my personal wellness trainer. Just like we have a trainer in physical gym. So here you can either talk to her and she's going to nod, or she's going to reciprocate your feelings. That is done by NLP. Or you can also do a simple workout. So here you can input on what are you dealing with and what you want to improve on. And of course, in the real solution, we are going to make it more empathetic, where they're going to ask you and it becomes much easier for you to open up. There is level one, and here in level one, we want to understand our emotions. In the real game, we are going to shoot the balloons, something like that. Right now, the game is under development, but this is how it will feel. Emotional gym with a trainer and a lot of different workouts for a lot of different problems, just like you have a lot of different equipment for different parts of your body. Next slide, please. So the technology behind the product, we're going to use NLP and Unity. NLP is natural language processing that is used for making sure that the Siri or some other name of the well-being trainer is going to reciprocate your feelings. And Unity will help us build amazing graphics that make sure that the game is engaging. Next slide, please. So we want to make it, of course, we want to earn money out of it so that we can scale and impact a lot of people. In fact, since it's a technology platform, we can reach out to almost lakhs and crores of people if they're liking. So the business viability is, we want to have in-app purchases, just like a lot of games have, like you have extra lives, you have extra power-ups, or you have extra cheat codes, something like that, so that they can get more insights and also can pay us money. And in the future, we want to use it as a subscription model for startups, because we can have a psychologist on the app for startups when we go there, and we can tell that this is a cost effective for having just a psychologist, because then you need to just go and talk to them. Right now you can play games and improve your well-being, and if needed, you can go and talk to them. So most of the work is done by the games. So since manpower is decreasing, the cost becomes reduced. So it becomes a much cost-effective solution for startups, as they are dealing with very bad work-life balance and very aggressive goals and uncertainty, etc. Next slide, please. So basically what we want to do is, mental health care is now made stigma-free and a scalable solution which we can practically cater to lakhs and crores of people. Thank you so much. I'm open for questions.
Thank you, Tarun, for that. Hideki-san, you have any comment? Yeah.
Hi. Thank you, Tarun. It's a very wonderful presentation. I'm impressed especially the visual and very simple chart. But maybe you spend a lot of time to make final presentation, and maybe you created a lot of demonstration, a prototype, and so on. It's very good. And also, your passion is excellent. I guess because of this content itself and this idea itself come from your experience, right? So that's why you became the very good persona. This usually the persona is a kind of the virtual person, but yourself. That's why we feel the passion. So, and also the actually the Fumiko-san made some of that chat now. And this problem itself is very worldwide. And but you can focusing on the just one person as a human-centric approach. And after that, you can expand very easily, I guess. So this idea is very good. Of course, most important thing is the content of the game itself. You just mentioned the under construction and so maybe shooting the balloon and so on. But this attractiveness of the game itself is the most important portion. And also, how to expand how a user can know your service is that kind of promotion portion is very important, because many of the young people who has a mental problem and so on, maybe they don't want to search any the good service which is not a mental service, but what? So it's very difficult to reach your the service, maybe. So that's fine. Please think how to promote this service is very good to the young people. Thank you very much, and I hope I will play with you again future.
Thank you.
Next we have Ashray.
Next slide, please. So good morning, one and all. My name is Ashray. I'm a final year BTech student. And today I'm going to present you my solution towards the problem faced by the asthma patients. Next slide, please. So asthma is a respiratory disease in which airways present in our lungs swell, which basically lead to difficulty in breathing. But this is not the only problem faced by the asthma patients. There are also many other problems faced by them. So let's go through them. First of all, let us imagine ourselves as an asthma patient. We have to follow a lot many restrictions. And after that, we also need to visit hospital for the frequent consultation and also go through the uneasy diagnosis procedure. Then we also need to bear and see the stress taken by our caretaker or by our mother. And we also need to wait in the long queues. This needs to be performed every 2 weeks. It sounds very hectic, right? Yes, it is. And this is the case of my friend Nitin. Next slide, please. Nitin is a 21-year-old guy who's suffering from asthma since his childhood. He has to take a lot of precautions and also has to maintain many restrictions. And this basically leads him to take a lot of stress. While coming to his mother, Mrs. Kamla, she has to take extra care and a special care of Nitin all the time. She also has to travel with her son because due to his condition. Me and Nitin often hang out together and I mostly find him very tensed and very stressed all the time. And I also find him that he does not enjoy any moment completely due to his condition. Next slide, please. Initially, I thought that this is because of lack of treatment in asthma, but that was not the case when I took his interview. I found that the problem to be different. When I took the interview, I realized that Nitin feels agonized when he has to visit the hospital frequently, has to wait in the long queues, and also visit the doctor for the consultation, also go through the diagnosis procedure, which is sometimes very uneasy, it seems, and also wait for the reports. After all this, he again has to visit the doctor. While coming to his mother, she is very stressed up as she has to take special care of Nitin and also traveled with him along to the hospital. And she also complains that COVID-19 has even worsened the situation. Next slide, please. So after collecting all these insights, I finally realized that what is required is not a treatment for asthma, but instead a change or ease in the procedure. I, as an engineer, took this as a challenge, and I felt that innovations can fight this problem. There is no requirement of any new technology over here, but rather an idea to utilize the existing technology properly. Next slide, please. Finally, I came up with the idea BreatheInvest. BreatheInvest is a respiratory diagnostic device which comes with a smart application. With this vest, patients can self-diagnose themselves and also can view the results and also get instant reports which will be present in the smart application. Next slide, please. BreatheInvest is implemented under machine learning and biomedical engineering. Under biomedical engineering, it consists of stethoscopes present at the back of the vest, which is basically used to hear the respiratory sounds of the patient. And through the hollow tube, it will then transmit the respiratory sounds to the smart application. The smart application is basically running under a machine learning algorithm, which basically takes the input from the stethoscopes, analyzes it, and compares it with the data set. And with whatever data set it is finally matched, that will be displayed as a result to the patient. Next slide, please. So this is the overall design of the vest. As you can see, the stethoscopes are placed at the back of the vest, and that is according to the auscultation points of the patient. The vest is then further connected to the smart application through an audio cable. And with the smart application, the patient can start the diagnosis procedure and also view the result, and also it can get the instant reports. One of my future goals over here is to make this device as a personal doctor. My major aim over here is to build tech gadgets that can help ourselves for our future existence. Next slide, please. have worked on many projects since my schooling, and which were well appreciated as well. I feel passionate towards aircraft, modern rocket science, and as well as healthcare too. Few of my recent projects includes a smoke detector drone, a model rocket booster that is reusable, and also a COVID-19 diagnostic system. COVID-19 diagnostic system was basically to detect COVID-19, and I have also demonstrated it to several doctors, which well appreciated it as well. I have also tested around 40 people on it, and in which 5 came out to be positive too. So, technical skills what I've implemented over here were majorly IoT, product design and development, research and development, and as well as web development too. Next slide, please. Coming to the business viability, out of considering the total population of Hyderabad, there are 5% people who are suffering from respiratory diseases, and I find them as my target users. With the increase in pollution and as well as the respiratory infections, I find that breathing vest could be a device which will be very helpful in this case. And it should also be a device which should be recommended at least one per household. Next slide, please. So let us go over a few stats and then make a smart choice. So when we consider the situation, if we are going to a diagnostic center for the diagnosis, we have to pay per test, then also bear the traveling cost. We have to put our great efforts and also consider COVID-19 risk, and the entire procedure takes more than 2 hours. When compared to the breathing vest, we just need to pay once. We can self-diagnose ourselves whenever we want. We can get instant reports, and all this can occur within 10 minutes of time. And the entire procedure can be performed at your comfort zone, that is at your home. I feel that technology should be something that should be affordable by everyone. We often feel that we need new technology to solve the new problems, but this is not the case every time. We just need to have an idea, or the question arises over here is that, are we utilizing the existing technology properly or not? Devices such like breathing vest can be very useful to solve problems like these, and it may be also useful in pandemics such like COVID-19. Next slide, please. Well, coming to the end, I just would like to highlight that our life is in our hands, and no healthcare provider will be as much concerned as we are towards ourselves. Well, that's it from my side. So guys, be safe. And the most important thing over here, self-care yourself. Thank you so much.
That was very insightful. Any questions? Yeah, sure.
Yeah, that was great. Really appreciate the work that you are doing. And I think you are a born inventor because you have done so many things.
Thank you, sir.
Pursue that path. Just a couple of questions. So when you said the procedure of treatment is what is the pain point, that's the insight that you got and you're trying to solve that. Using stethoscope to detect your breathing patterns and then analyzing, is that the only procedure that is involved in detection, or are there more to it? Because I recently had a permanent PFT test, they call it, right? Where you have to breathe into something, and that seemed very something which, again, you can probably adopt here, you know, have a pipe there, we can breathe and then do the analysis. So, you know, have you considered exploring more,
yes,
adding more some simpler things that we can do to this?
Yeah, the PFT test, which is
pulmonary functional test. Yeah. I recently got myself done that.
Yes. So, as you might see, sir, the procedure is not very, and considering the present situation, the procedure is not good, I feel.
Yeah.
As we have to change the pipe every time. But here, in this case, it's just a vest. We just need to wear it and according to our comfort, and then start the diagnosis procedure.
Yeah.
So, and then we will basically analyze the respiratory sounds.
So you're going to add that breathing pipe thing also in this product?
No, sir. I'm going to consider the respiratory sounds of the patients, and that's it.
I mean, that's what I'm saying, because the challenge that I faced there, that's the insight I'm giving you,
yeah,
that there are very few hospitals who have that. PFT test, maybe because it's very expensive or whatever. But to me, it seemed like a very simple thing. They're just, I'm breathing into it and it's just detecting how, just doing some post analysis and showing me a graph, you know, which I feel that in this West itself, you can add that functionality and that it becomes a holistic, you know, a tool for any kind of respiratory related detection is what I'm thinking. Okay. And also you have to be mindful of the cost. I think it should not be very expensive.
Right? No, sir. It is not expensive.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Praveen. Very nice presentation, very thoughtful, I felt, at least in terms of how you put together a solution of that kind. So asthma is a clinical condition, right? It's a medical condition and it often requires supervision of medical professionals to be able to identify and diagnose it. And I'm assuming your algorithm eventually will get there to be able to identify and diagnose it like a medical professional.
Yeah.
Now, for solutions like this to obtain clinical or medical acceptance, have you thought through what you might need to be able to do or should be doing in order to get a wider acceptance from the medical community as well? And those could be potential go-to-market partnerships. Which you might need to ride on in order to make sure it is accepted at a wider scale. So something which I wanted to just highlight, because that could be an impediment as you potentially aim to scale this in a bigger way.
Thank you. Let's take a small break here. We have next four teams coming up in next 10 minutes. The cookies and the refreshments are in the cafeteria. Please ensure that you don't carry them back. We do not have refreshments or beverages in the events room. Let's assemble back at 11:35. Thank you. The way is over this side.
Is it Shalini?
This is Priyanka.
Oh, Priyanka, okay.
Hi.
Yeah, myself, PME from Toshiba.
Hi, yeah.
Actually, you know, I know Shalini and also, I mean, I think guys have been invited by Shalini.
Yes, yes.
I actually pinged to this, I don't know, who is that lady, Pratyush, I think, on the e-waste. Okay. Yeah, I gave a message to them that they can contact me after the, I mean, the meeting is over or complete.
Sure.
Because I, apart from Toshiba, even handle the kind of waste management on a global forum, like. So I'm heading, I mean, I'm the president for 3R Zero Waste, you know, kind of company, the foundation as well as company. So I would like to, you know, try to support to these guys who are doing the e-waste, because e-waste is also part of that, like.
Understood. So I'll do something. I'll connect. I have your contact details, so I'll connect them with you.
You can connect them like to me after.
Sure.
Because I don't know whether they are when you, I'm connected to TM and TM is connected to me. That's I've been doing.
Sure. Yes, PM. We'll make sure that we get you connected.
Yeah, thank you.
Hi, Abby. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Sorry, I was... Abby? Sorry, Priyanka. I'm just testing the... Okay, I just want to test the audio.
Yes, Erica.
Okay, can you speak for, like, say anything?
Yeah, so... Is there any echo happening in my...
No, voice? You sound okay. You sound good.
Okay,
there's no echo. It's sounding
perfect.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Sorry, we just wanted to test that.
Sure.
Fumiko, sir.
She'll be on in a second. Yes, I think she can hear you now. Sorry, I had my headset off. This is Fumiko speaking, sorry.
Oh, yeah, Fumiko-san, I just wanted to understand. When I missed the portion while you're presenting. Talking, I miss. So I just wanted to, you know, in the break time, could you just reiterate your thing? Like, I would like to hear, because in between I was disconnected for a while.
Sorry, I got a little bit of line cut. Could you repeat? Sorry, I couldn't hear the question itself.
No, in between I missed your session. Like, you know, when you are present, you
are talking. Okay, thank you for.
During this break time, chotto hanashimasu, daijoubu?
Oh, yes, sure. Wow, you speak Japanese. Oh, my God.
Yeah.
That was so unexpected.
日本語何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を何を Tokyo ni to Nishikawa Nishikasai wakaru na?
Nishikasai.
Nishikasai. Jode sunnai masu watashi.
So desu ka.
あ、そうですね。すごい。今日はこの回のことは、プリアに聞いたのかな?
How did you know about this?
ね、私はとTHUBで、constant interaction ですと、THUB。
I see.
Kind of to私と、more like attached to THUB, like for meaning.
Nice.
And that's how I connected. So,
I see.
Kanagawa? Fumiko-san? From Kanagawa?
No, I'm based in Tokyo.
Oh, no, Tokyo, okay. Tokyo, doko ni?
Tokyo, but near Ueno. Yes, it's very close from Ueno.
But originally from?
No, originally from Hiroshima.
Hiroshima.
So it makes a lot of sense for me to do this program.
yeah, very much. Hiroshima, Nagasaki, you know, that's a kind of thing. It still it is.
Yes, it's a very special, unique place in a way. Yes. It's lovely that you have joined. Thank you so much. And also giving some very supportive comments to the participants.
Yeah, it's like, you know, I mean, I try to do what's best, you know, I mean, to support whatever knowledge I try to share.
That's amazing because with the Hiroshima companies, I think every finalist has to sort of explore together on what topic and the project they would work on together with the Hiroshima companies. Whereas I think they also have their own topics and projects which can be also pursued in India. So yeah. If you have any kind of suggestions and ways that they can continue their paths, I think that will be very, it'll be really great.
Yeah, you're right. I agree. I learned many of things from, you know, Nihonjin. Nihonjin wa to tottemo ii desu.
Sugoi. Nishikasai ni itatte sugoi desu ne. Do you still keep in touch with the companies here in Japan?
Yeah, I've been across Japan and, you know, walking around, I was there. I mean, I like the people and also the thing, because I learned all many things from Japan. Japanese people, wow, in time sense and discipline and humbleness and all that. So,
wow,
wherever I go, no, I mean, so how I greet and all that, I really like. So,
great.
I even participated in Tokyo Toastmasters Club, like I was a member of them.
Wow.
Yeah, Tokyo Toastmasters Club, I was there, like, so.
Right. So I you had a very close.
Ohayou gozaimasu. Ima to konnichiwa. Konnichiwa, Segawa-san.
Mute してた. Ah, doumo konnichiwa. Nanka nihongo de
shabette. Konnichiwa na.
So strange.
Ohayou gozaimasu is already closed because 12 o'clock in Japan. Ima to it's like 3:30. Dakara ima konnichiwa.
Yeah, that's about
3
o'clock.
Yes, yes. But now is just from the center of the winter, so that's why the sunset is soon. So yeah, almost sunsetting now.
Your backdrop is very good. Like, I mean, like, you know, something like sakura in a different kind. I mean, I see your backdrop behind you, the whole of snowy and all that. You are also from Osaka or Tokyo? Segawa-san, from which place?
Kawasaki City, just for the next of Tokyo.
So, I mean, my office in Surumi, after Kawasaki.
Oh, really? Sugoi local talk.
It's very specific place. Oh, my God. It's very local.
Inoue-san is giving a kind of comment. We're going to start in 1 minute. Inoue-san.
Okay.
Yes.
So,
Inoue-san wa ima. Konnichiwa, Inoue-san.
Konnichiwa.
Shoshiburi. I'm trying to get connected with you. Fumiko-san and Segawa-san. Maybe you can just share your line ID or the contact so that, you know, I can keep in touch with you regarding any other thing, because I may come to Japan in January or February. Like.
Oh, wow.
Oh, really?
After the meeting, we will share the numbers. Okay. Yeah, please continue.
Yes. Yes. And then if anything goes wrong, Priya can make sure that we can be in touch. So Priya is our primary channel, so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure, I'll get that. Thank you.
Great.
Thank you very much.
We'll start in next 30 seconds. I'll let everyone know.
Okay, just a moment, we will call them to the venue again.
No, chill. Erika-san, I think next we have Treehouse, right?
Hi, sorry, there's some trouble with Treehouse, so let's just go ahead with Neha.
Okay, sure.
Okay.
Niharika, you're okay? Yeah. So next we have Niharika from Treehouse. She's here.
Hello. Can I
start. A very good morning to dignitaries on the dais and my fellow innovators present here. I'm Niharika Vadluri. Can you please put the next slide so that they can get a glimpse of myself? Next one. So I am a 21-year-old tech freak, or you can say an enthusiast who love making innovative stuff. And I'm not yet graduated yet. I'm not yet graduated due to COVID. So, and not yet graduated due to COVID. And my passion are developing hardware products, singing, dancing. I'm a public speaker at Toastmasters, an international organization. And technical skills is I am into complete open source from past 2.5 years. I develop desktop versions, hardware, firmware, and which consists of assistive technology, AI, embedded into them. And so I have a question before I proceed on. How many of you are using screens 24/7? I can see she's using a screen and you are using a screen. Every one of us are using screens. Without screens, life has become hard. Can you put the next slide, please? Before COVID, before pandemic has happened, lockdown, it was shown that about 7 hours, 22 minutes, teens were on screen usage 24/7 using it like that. And estimated time was 7 hours and 22 minutes. This was without doing homework or other presentations that they used to do. Thanks to COVID, now even the homework, presentation, projects, everything, Netflix, online shopping, online dance classes, everything has become online. People have stuck themselves to screens. And I am also the example. Everything, I wrote my exams online. I never thought I'd write my exams online. Writing exams, everything was online. So this was absurd. And this outbreak was more during the COVID time. And the most affected people were teens and adolescents. So what were the problems and health issues that were reported due to this COVID pandemic and screening time was, first one, myopia. How many of you are having myopia here? Nearsightedness increased. People who don't have sight also developed sight. Headache, mental health. Tarun, who already presented before, also mentioned health, mental health issues increase and what not. Next slide, please. So these are some of the insights that research things that I have taken into picture. Can you put the next? Okay. So my user here is not only the teens, we are also teens, adolescents, teens. So people between all the online classes attending, students between the age of 12 to 25. This includes middle school, high school, and university students like us. So these are the users, and the context is that along with the other activities that they use it to do on screen, that is watching Netflix or doing their project documentations, presentations. Now 24 hours of time, 9 to 8 hours of online classes have become add-on. So what is this happening is that this became another issue, that is an add-on of online classes during the lockdown has increased the screen time more. Now the pain is that people like me are unable to understand, should I pay all the 8 hours sitting in front of the screens for the online classes, after that do the projects online, do the presentations online. So it's like I'm unable to concentrate on the projects and other stuff that I want to do because of the online classes themselves are making me tiring. So this is what the pain is that I've understood. And next slide, please. So insights that I've collected is my experience and my classmates and the other university, whole university students, and also some of the teenagers, like my cousins I've interviewed, I can tell you in the next slides. That is online classes, what they want is should be easy, short, and enjoyable. They want teachers to have the mindset to make them give stretch warm-ups in between a diversion. And other thing is that should have something that can tell them about screen brightness, light conditions, and atmospheric conditions that they are in. And along with that, also they told that screen time causes hair fall, spondylitis, and other issues too that are being reported. So taking all this as insight, what I came to a conclusion is that the solution that people want is to have a kind of technology or a software which will ease their day-to-day work activities. That is, technology should, along with easing your day-to-day activities, it should also maintain your health. Because health as well as the screen time are two major stuff that were taken out of the picture.
So they want the technology should be in such a way that they should ease their day-to-day work activities and also should maintain the physical and mental health. How can this be done as the solution that I've come up with? That is build a, this is my cousin, and this was in 2019 before lockdown, and this is after lockdown. Just in 8 months of span, she has got myopia and sight. This is all due to the pressure of online classes. She's in 10th standard now. So she was one of the insight or the interviewer that I've taken into picture. And the next slide, please. So the next slide. So my idea here is to build an application. Innovation usually takes place when you combine hardware and software. This is what I believe in. Not a single thing can work. So first, what I decided is to bring up a software or application that will have a screen monitoring and brightness system, as I was mentioning in my insight before. That is Pangolin screen brightness. This is something that we have already developed. This is somewhere, this is a software that I've developed last year under my Google internship. This is a CNET open source software. This automated, this is custom built, and it maintains your screen brightness according to the light conditions that you are in. If you are in dark light conditions, it automatically develops. And so this is just a website. It's currently like you have to download
the software
this.
Is not installed.
No, I did not install. I've changed it Linux to Windows, so I could not. No, that is just the GUI I'm able to show you. So that is the website that you have built. That is, it automatically sets the screen brightness according to your light conditions. How can it set according to your light conditions is that one simple formula is when you are attending online classes, your webcam is always on. So the webcam here, another software you can use is OpenCV or a computer AI that can screen your conditions, your surrounding, and as your webcam is on, this will easily detect the conditions that you are in and according to that adjust the screen time. Here the problem of screen timing is solved. That is one thing. And the other thing is that I was telling about spondylitis and the other issues that people, you know, 24/7 keep getting mental health issues. Other one is posture correction. So this posture correction is actually another feature that I wanted to add. I'm currently working upon. Here the person, the webcam already is on during online class. When it is focusing on yourself, whenever you're changing your posture like this or like this or like this, like whenever you're sitting in a straight posture or when you're turning yourself, then it gets a time limit where it feels that your posture is getting too much over stretch. It will immediately give you a reminder, posture reminder. Set yourself straight or do some warm ups, sit erect, something like that. It will give you a posture action where a little bit of health issue or people who are having spondylitis can actually have a check every time. So this process can be done in the form of getting desktop notifications. In app, this is one of the best features that iOS and Android versions, it's not yet released. So I'm thinking to work upon it. This is an iOS screen time. You can see the screen time is already recorded. It's default you get in iOS. It reminds 2 hours, 25 minutes, daily average, social networking, creativity, productivity. So in this way, already the whole for every 21 minutes pickup time, how much is it? So the mobile version screen times are also being recorded on the mobiles. So this is how the screen time in mobile versions is being reported. But how can you get it on the desktop version is that through desktop notifications. You have one software called as Win10TOS. You can search it on the internet, Win10TOS. What this Win10TOS does is that it is a very easy software. You can just link it to the other software that you are building upon. It immediately alerts the notifications, custom build notifications, we say. This Win10TOS allows us to build a custom build notifications according to the notifications that you want to give on the desktop screen, like screen time used this much or the brightness is this much. Lower it, and other stuff is like posture can also come in the form. So in this way, you can get all the notifications in desktop version and iOS and Android, as I was mentioning, Android is not yet built and I am sure I can work on it. This is in default got on iOS. So these are three things I felt could actually be done because even this can be solved only through screening. Already you're spending a lot of time on screen. Why don't you get even the stuff to solve your issues on screen? telling you, making your work easier. So this is what my idea is to build, and that is build software. Can you put the next slide? Next slide. Okay, these are some of the software. Python is one of the best user-friendly software. Many can say Java, because I find Java complex, to be honest. I'm a Python developer. I'm into MicroPython and Python. So I feel the Django framework is very easy to build a website. And also, when it comes to further technologies,
two more minutes.
Further technologies, if you want to implement on, if you want to link your software to hardware, as I was mentioning, innovation comes from connecting your software to hardware. Next slide, please. MicroPython and Python framework is very easy to implement on hardware. So that is why I chose Python rather than Java, because Java has JDK, files, JSTL, a lot of things to come up with. Python makes the framework easier. And business viability, all the things that I'm using here are free open source. There's not even a single penny going into it. All the softwares are free open source. You can get it on Google Apps. You can get it on CNET. CNET has almost all the software are open source. So you can get everything is open source. And coming to the customers, all people like us, and you can easily install onto your desktop once it's started developing. And Pangolin is already there. I will suggest you to install software on your laptop. It tells you about your screen brightness. It adjusts according to it. So all the versions here available are free, and every one of us can use it. And it can also help schools, colleges that I was mentioning before. If this rule is made that during the online classes, the teacher tells to install this app or software, just like the Google Meet or Zoom that they tell to install while attending online classes. If there is something that can be made to reach schools, universities to install this desktop version or this software, it would be very easy. People will find it fun too. And last slide. For further developments, you can. I'm planning to get this onto a hardware too.
Next slide, please.
Next slide, last. I want to get it onto okay, it's not there. Okay, it's okay. I want to get it onto the hardware too. We have specs, right? We all have specs. In specs, if you can see, there is a hard disk or a pen drive kind of stuff that is coming onto your specs to make it smart. That is the whole version that I've shown here. Software is coming embedded into the specs itself. Or the people who don't have specs can also use it as a pen drive. That it has a pen drive connection. You can use it as a pen drive too, or it can come in the form of specs onto your on your specs. It can come on as a device onto your specs. So that is further very complex, because it has to come onto the hardware. Until this software is not built, it can't come onto the hardware. So those are the things that I want to work on, and this is what my solution is.
Thank you, Neha. Any questions? I think we are running a bit late. One comment or question from anyone online or offline?
Sure. So that actually gives you the usage of how much you're going to do it. So did you able to think about how you can able to link up that? Because that helps you to focus time for yourself, how much time you're spending on your emails, how much time linking the same thing.
Yes, sir. Actually, that is inbuilt feature that comes in Microsoft versions. But my concentration was not carrying all those other activities to my target was only concentrating on the screen time that is being used. So that is kind of getting notifications in the form of notifications. Usually Microsoft Data Analytics and what those things do is that they give you in the form of email alerts, or you get it in the form of Dropbox notifications. They link it to Dropbox or binge.com, something like that. They are linked to that. So every time you have to open the software and look into it, other than getting the notification of that onto the screen.
Okay. Good. At least good that you have exposed that also. Thank you.
So what I have two questions is, if you are going to run a Python daemon in your laptop when other things are happening, in the sense video calls or whatever, how much of CPU cycles are you going to use? How are you going to optimize your CV algorithms to make sure that it doesn't negatively impact the performance of the laptop, right? Because you're saying that you're going to run this thing most likely always, right? Because to detect the posture, to running. So CVs are CPU intensive operations, yeah. And they would require good amount of optimization, which standard laptops, which people have, may not function as good as you want to. So you have to think those hard problems.
Yes.
And
actually, that's a point that I've actually first looked into, because all the laptops are not of the same versions and same capabilities. That's the reason I came up with, if it does not work with the laptop or giving any problems, we can go with the mobile app version too.
But if I'm using laptop, not using mobile phone, so you have to find a solution to that, and maybe it's not necessary that the software runs all the time also, because you can trigger a daemon every 5 minutes, you see what he's doing, something like that. So those kind of things. But while it is functioning, my video calls should not get hanged, or if I'm working, if I'm compiling a huge code, it should not. So those are the things that we have to take care. But yeah, it's a good start. Go ahead with that. Yeah.
Thank you, Neha. Next, we have Abhijit. Abhijit, can you unmute yourself? Can you check if he's on?
Abby, I can't spotlight you unless you have your video on, it seems. Can you hear me?
Abhijit, can you hear us? Because we cannot hear you. And please turn on your video so that we can ping you to the screen.
Okay,
yeah, cool.
Abby, we can't hear you. Maybe try unmuting the other mobile audio. We still can't hear you.
We still can't hear you.
So there's two mobiles, Abby. I think you might have to. Okay.
I still can't hear you. Maybe just log off and log in. In the meanwhile, we'll have next presenter.
Okay. Sorry, Venkat.
Venkat, are you there? Yeah.
Next slide.
Can you go to next slide?
How many of you have started cooking during the lockdown? Something like new dishes, Chinese dishes or something. Yeah, you would have gone through this cycle, right? It is very interesting. So this is my idea.
Next slide.
Next slide. My initial problem was, we have all learned cooking and a lot of us have lost jobs also, or some opportunities. You have seen many labor workers, or even some IT employees being laid off. They were interested in cooking and opening some venture in the same lines. But what I thought was, they were completely, having no knowledge on setting some cart, because there were no such people in this market. Think about one housewife of an IT employee who has been laid off recently. She has more experience in cooking, but she can't set up a cart, because I think that these are the problems. She doesn't know how to collect the money. She doesn't know how hygiene standards are to be maintained, or where to purchase any wholesale goods, how to design the cart, and what kind of regulations go into to set up a constant business. Because once you set it up, it should run constantly. So this is what I thought. Like, these are the problems the new vendors face. And even the established vendors face problems with some of these. This is what I thought. So when, the next slide. So my initial solution was, I'll just simply create a website. Sitting in my room, I'll create a website and a telephone helpline so that these new vendors or established vendors can come on, okay, say, I have this problem. Okay, I am a new street vendor. I have these problems. You talk to us or the stakeholders like the wholesale dealers or, you know, such kind of people, designers, and you solve out your problems. You iron it out. But the problem was these solutions only satisfy intellectual requirement. I can only provide intellectual support. That doesn't materialize into any financial support or, you know, any physical support. It is just intellectual support. In this period, it is important. But for street vending, which is a physical task, merely providing intellectual support is not fulfilling. The next slide. Next slide. Yeah. So these are my user insights. I went out in the market. I saw street vendors vending fruits, vegetables, one person selling bajis, mirchi bajis, one person selling pani puris. I have talked to customers of those vending carts itself. I got some insights from them. When I interviewed them, my assumptions were wrong, because even if I'm sitting at home and cooking, it doesn't mean that I don't know where to collect money, and it doesn't mean that I don't know how to maintain hygiene. I surely know that. But the problem is finding a place to vend. Where should I go to vend? Where should I put my cart up? I can take an aluminium basin and make bhel puri and go sell it somewhere. But where should I go? Where should I set up the stall? This was one major reason. See, when I went to the bhaji stall, he refused to take a pic because he said few regulators have put a fine on him. And also the fruit seller said the same thing. Because vehicles were stopping there, traffic police are starting to force him to remove his shop. Because that's a problem. If you don't have a correct place, you will face such problems. The second thing is, few vendors said that if there is some process in between, the cart is becoming costly. That means if you have a stove, it will increase the cart cost by 2 lakhs. Because if you go by regulation, you need to have a fire extinguisher. You need to have the hygiene standards. You need to have workplace. You need to have place to evacuate. Such all concerns that raise the cost to 2 lakhs from 50,000 itself. But it can be lowered down. That's what I observed. When I spoke to one of the government official who has worked with 2 lakh vendors, he said that if there are carts which are selling direct products, that means if you are selling only vegetables, raw vegetables, customers are starting to bargain a lot. If I say 100 rupees a kg, they'll say 50, you give it to me 50 rupees a kg. But if I sell a cut watermelon, you won't bargain, right? You will say, okay, 20 rupees is fine for me, I'll eat it. So he said that if there is a process on the cart, that cart will sell soon and that cart will generate more revenue than selling the mere product. So it should have some process. Can I have the next slide? Next slide. So this was the actual problem. This was the actual problem. The new vendor knows some of the stuff, but it is important to know where to put up the cart, how to design it, and what regulations that go into it. These are the three problems. Now, there should be a solution which can solve these three problems. That's enough. Then the vendor can come in and, you know, start the business. So converged the solution. It came close. Before, it was more diverse. And it spanned a lot of markets and a lot of, you know, issues. But this converged. Now, my solution is, the next slide. Next slide. The solution is, okay, now there are a lot of vacant lands in Hyderabad, you know, in major cities, there are a lot of vacant lands, might be some litigation or something, there's some problem, but they're not achieving any revenue. So, okay, I lease that land, I'll take that land somewhere, you know, which is on the main road or somewhere, I'll take that land. Then I'll assemble a team who will design modular carts. The problem, the cost of carts are more is because there are very few vendors and also very few designers. It is very close market, right? When I go to, say, Solapur, the cart of Bajji is 20,000. But that itself in Hyderabad is 80,000. This is very dynamic pricing. The same cart, same material, same requirements. It was very dynamically priced. So if we come together as, you know, a network, we can bring down the cart cost. So I'll provide that low cost cart. Then those regulatory permissions. If the place is there, if the place of vending is there, I need not bother about regulatory permissions. But still, there are few food safety and fire safety concerns. I can provide them help with that if they are having their own place, or I can provide it within the land I'm going to lease. The next one. Next slide. This is how my solution flows. If you are an established vendor who has already business, you can buy the cart, get the regulatory support and go on, move forward. You just buy the cart and you can leave. But if you are a new vendor, you will lease the cart. Instead of buying it for 20 or 80,000 rupees, now I'll say, okay, you pay me just from your daily income, you lease the place along with the cart and you start vending. You start vending, you will learn how your customers are, attracted to the product in the same land. So now you learn those basics. And if you don't know where to lend, you can lend in the same leased land. Otherwise, if you know where to lend, you can go, but it will be a restriction because if you leave the leased land, we can't track you. So there will be a small restriction on the movement. Finally, if the business is successful, pay the remaining amount for the cart and move out. That's it. It's very easy to set up a business. In this chain, it's very easy to set up the business. Next slide. Next slide. So this is a pani puri, which I thought will be a better dish to design or model my cart on. So this is a model cart I have designed. Now I said, okay, in the present time, the requirements are wastage tanks. There are these wastage tanks. This blue one is a biocompactor. So whatever wet waste is there, you will compact it. Whatever dry waste is there, you'll put it there because dry waste doesn't take a lot of space. This is a RO purifier. So you will get a purified water from the whole base tank is filled with water and this will purify that water. So then there are solid storage tanks, like these pani puris are solid, so they stay in these tanks. Then there are liquids that go into the cylindrical tanks and there's an induction stove. Such modular carts, now see, it's a plug and play model, right? If you want to sell, say, some other street food, you can just, remove these tanks or insert new tanks or something like that. And then it's insert some batteries or a waste wall. This is a waste wall. Such kind of, modular components you can plug and play. That's it. It's very easy to produce such cards and it will be at very low cost. Next slide. Next slide. Why I was interested in such project, because as I returned from UK, I saw that the most loving carts, which I used to go before going there, were depleted. They were not having any customers. They faced a lot of problems. They said before lockdown, no one had to pay any fines or, even if traffic is there, it's there, that's it. No one used to care about that. Now, they are saying that because their income sources are depleting, more fines are being levied on, such activities. So, and also they said finding a place with such, no constraints was very hard for them. So I thought, okay, I should take on such idea where, I can provide them some support. And then after they close down on their problems, they can go out and, vend it. So before this, I have connected a network of plastic and aluminium manufacturers. I've went to their shops. I've interacted with them. I have seen how the work goes. And I have understood what supply chain problems they are facing. The real vendor would not charge you that much, but the middleman is charging you that much. The middleman is charging you extensively because they will get the carts manufactured at a wholesale cost and then they'll start retailing at very different prices. That was the problem. So that had to be solved. Then I also, to support this idea, I depend on my computational skills a bit because new components require some kind of IoT skills, to put it in the car. But basically, I depend on the mechanical design skills so that I can design such carts and sell it out. Next slide. Next slide. Yeah. So previously, I worked on such projects. These are my hackathon projects where, you know, I work for a healthcare innovations center where I developed these two prototypes. Then recently I have collaborated with T-Works and developed a sanitizing drone, which was the idea of a kit. And then this is a modular wind turbine, which inspired me, because this is a very modular wind turbine. This is what I designed in the past, and this is what inspired me to reduce the cost. Next slide. Next slide. So resources to implement this idea. At least one mechanical and electrical engineer are required to design such products and put it out. Then I need a business and sales manager who can control the outreach of the idea. So to reach out new vendors and, you know, get the leads. Then a POC could be created within 3 months, because it is very easy. Aluminium and plastic manufacturers take very less time. And a website needs to be developed to manage all the information and publicize the idea more. Next slide. Next slide. Yeah. So why I think my business is viable? As I was mentored by Srikant, he said that Ola Foods, it's a big example. Khichdi experiment and Paratha experiment got new migrant laborers, new jobs. They were cloud kitchens. Why not make street vendors also, you know, give that power so that they can vend to such cards or such delivery apps, and also, you know, they have more physical customers also, both the ways. They will get empowered both the ways. Then why I think it is, a profitable business. Right now, after lockdown, there was a tea stall that was set up in very remote area of Chintal area. So he was earning around 7,000 rupees a day. And average labor income in Hyderabad is 700 rupees a day. Migrant laborers are looking for such opportunities. So they want such opportunities. And that's why I think this business could be viable. Next slide. Next slide. So looking forward, how can this idea progress forward? I was thinking, why only, you know, constrained on street food? Only, why only food? Okay, now plants require some nurturing. They are already nurseries, but they still require some nurturing. So, okay, we can get some process and put them on the cart. And also plastics. Now, novelty plastics, which are coming up, you can, it's a very far shot idea. Just the thing is, you need to 3D print on the cart, such kind of idea. It's a very far-sought idea, but still it can be done. So such kind of new ideas, you know, we can progress on the carts. The next thing is, we can sustain this food business model by making it a gig-based model. That means you call us, you call that I need a cart for, you know, say 1 hour or two, like in a gated community or something like that. You call and you get the cart at your disposal. So we can sustain such business. Next slide.
Next slide, please.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Any comments or questions, quick questions? One. Online or offline? Yeah.
Yeah, I think this is a great progress since we spoke last time. And I think this will definitely have a market, because most of us are hesitant to go to small stores because of the hygienic conditions. So if you can brand yourself, if you can reduce the cost of operations, and if you can really connect the customers to these cards, to various channels that you talked about, I think it'll have a scope. Yeah.
Thank you.
Abhijit, are you there? Can
yes.
you hear us?
Am I audible now?
Yes.
Thank you.
Sure. Just a second, we're just trying to pull out your slides. Yeah. Yes, Abhijit.
Let me start.
Yeah.
Yes. Can you, next slide? Let's say you bought some surprising clothes for your grandmother for her birthday, but maybe it ended up as an unfit or not suiting her really well, and she's pretending to be very happy in front of you, but actually mentally she is not satisfied.
here comes a solution, Trinetra. In English, it's called the third eye. So we are having a size estimation app using AI. Next slide, please. Myself, Abhijit Girin. I am a CS master student from IIT Hyderabad. You can call me techie. I love to impact lives of people using just pieces of code. And I am currently intern at Philips India as an AI engineer. I'm also worked in Vigil Lab as a machine learning researcher, where we used to solve some traffic surveillance problems. Also, I was working in Candle Lab. We used to solve some autonomous driving problems. Next slide. Here, elderly people is our target user. As we know, they are very uncomfortable moving out of their house, even traveling to shops or buying clothes. So normally what happens? They ask their children to buy some clothes for them. That is one context. And we know in India, at least 50% of the elderly people are digitally illiterate. They might know read and write, but coming to this digital things, my grandmother don't know even the signal, what is the sign of Wi-Fi. And if the remaining 50%, if they know online shop, again, there are very less limited stocks for them. Nobody really cares for their clothes and all. Next slide. Yeah, so after a lot of interviews and they're going through this process, we ended up very, very good enlightening perspectives. One is these elder people used to fake their happiness to their children when they give something, but they are struggling inside and sitting with the unfit garments. And the other funny part is even the children and grandchildren realize that she is pretending to be happy. And the whole uncomfortable scenario happens at home. Maybe some of you might have experienced the same. And the third perspective is they feel, these elderly people feel very inferior when they always depend on the children asking, oh, how to use this, how to take this, because of their digital illiteracy. And the fourth perspective is, we know the game of shipping and returns when we are ordering something on Amazon. It always happens in multiple iterations. And these elderly people really don't like to wait for this. Next slide, please. So what is the idea? So here I am presenting you Trinetra, the third eye. So we are creating an integration platform. And the core idea is we create a 3D model of the user just from the webcam using some machine learning algorithms. And again, the body measurements are estimated accurately, and this will be passed through the API. Next slide, please. So here we are offering a SaaS platform with a very seamless UI, and an easy API integration. And this 3D model, since we are creating a 3D model, the whole universe of clothes can be, we can try and test it out for the fitness. And ultimately, the whole thing is powered by AI, which makes it more and more powerful over time. Next slide. So I'll just show an app in action. So here my friend is giving a gift to my, grandmother. And she is not very happy. She is just keeping it in the cupboard. Next slide. Yeah, and someone introduces her with our app, Trinetra. And she is kind of curiously seeing what's it. And a 3D model is created of her using the webcam. And the next slide. And we ordered the thing, and she is getting the thing in hand, and she is really happy. You can see the real happiness in her face. So this is the psychological aspect of this. Next slide. So coming to the total addressable market, there is a 1,000 billion online fashion industry in the world. And in India, it's around 120 billion. And out of 900 million elderly people, around 280 million people do online shopping. And in India, it's around 20%. For 100%, 104 million, it's around 20 million. So am I really targeting this 280 million people in the world? No. Next slide. They are actually targeting the 1,000 billion sector, the whole industry. Why? Next slide. After a lot of research and analysis, we came to the conclusion that this is not at all specific to the elderly people. This is a very generalized idea. So the whole Nike market can be a pregnant woman who really needs a very customized clothes to fit their stomach, or the obese people who always look for plus size clothes stores in online. They are very cheap and mostly not satisfied. And the online boutique. So again, you can connect with the designers, with the customers. Again, the physical body measurement have to be sent. So all these problems can be solved with our app. Next slide. So we realized that this is a very generalized version, and this can be suited for any customer from any segment. You can see here all the pregnant people, all the Japanese kimono people, and all. So next slide. So I'll show you a small system design, a high-level overview. So everyone has a webcam or a mobile cam. So from this, we are creating a 3D model using, there is something called GANs, so to generate 3D models in technical terms. And again, using some machine learning libraries, we are going to estimate the perfect fit and the perfect size of the body measurements. And this can be, this data can be sent to either Amazon or any online e-commerce stores as an API service. So what are the benefit? Next slide. So here you can see normally what Amazon do to for cloth recommendations. They use something called collaborative filtering. What happens is it sees your past shopping history, and also it will see the other people who have purchased the same item. And using these two attributes, they try to recommend the new clothes for you. Next slide. Here we are going to add a very powerful attribute, the present body shape. This is very important. Why? Because after COVID, what happened? We all started work from home, and our body shape drastically changed. Either the tummy is grown or the body shape kind of changed. And if you go to Amazon, Amazon knows a person before 3 months. They don't know the present you. So if we give this attribute to the machine learning algorithms, it will become more and more powerful. Next slide, please. Yeah, so why I care about solving this problem? Because I have really faced this problem in my real life, when I deal with my grandparents, when I give in their birthdays. And even when I am shopping for myself, I always play this game of shippings and returns, and the convergence happens after multiple iterations. And as a tech person and an aspiring entrepreneur, I really see a huge market, a huge possibility in this sector. Next slide. Thank you. Thank you all for the support and attention.
Thank you, Abhi. Any questions or comments to Abhi?
Yeah. This is Ashutosh here. Hello, Abhijit.
Yes.
You had targeted the elderly people. I guess later part you realize that this is a common problem with everyone. In fact, even with people like you and me. And after lockdown, we have been buying more online. We haven't been going to the store where there were trial rooms where we could, you know, take a trial and buy the right fit. So during the last 3 months, around $12 billion worth of goods were sold during the festival sale on online platforms. And you'll not be surprised that almost 10% of that got returned because of size misfit issues or return issues. And that is like almost $1.2 billion if you're talking about $12 billion in the last 3 months itself. And sellers on these online platforms, they have to incur these costs. In fact, they keep a margin of, they have a substantial margin where they can, you know, account for these losses. So you're planning for an API, I mean, it's a good time. Second thing, what you can do is if you have got size data on sizes and all. There was a company called Wunik initially, which tried to do things a little differently. And what they tried to do is they tried to suggest you dresses according to your body's shape and size. So once you have the body data, I mean shape and size data, the next step is to train, you know, an algorithm and suggest the right fit for me. Possibly there could be certain dresses which are not the right fit, but I buy and then I later on realize that it's not fitting me well and I want to return it. You can go a step further and can not only save a lot of cost for sellers, the losses they face on returns, but it can also help them sell more. So all the best. Sounds like a good effort from your side, and keep it up.
Thank you, sir, for the insights.
Can I make a comment? You have time? Can I make a comment?
Yes, go ahead.
Okay?
Yes, sure.
Okay.
Perfect.
This is Hideki Segawa. Thank you very much, Abby. So I like the front posture. I mean, the fact that you are focusing on the elderly people, because your insight is very deep. Not only just a kind of the measurement of the body is very important for elderly people, but also the a kind of the elderly people is struggled or the actually I have a complaint but I cannot say, and the grandchildren side also they understand my grandfather is actually not satisfied with that kind of the insight is very impressive. So of course the measurement of the body size is very important. It's no question, especially online shop and so on. But first portion, front portion, I mean, when you are the investigate and dig deeply about the mentality and the emotion of the elderly people is very good. So. And also that you made a very good kind of story with the photo. That is very fun. And I don't know the exactly the Indian the government, but do you need to the accurate measure of the sari too? Sari is maybe very flexible, no?
Yeah, to be very frank, for the sari, we don't need it perfectly.
Yeah.
But even the AI can suggest a color preference, things like that.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Good.
So thank you everyone for the wonderful presentations. And now we want to recognize the efforts of the participants who have presented here. So we will have a certificates distribution now. I request Mr. Gopal and Srikant to come on the dais for the certificates distribution. So I welcome Pratisha Patibanda.
Next we have Teja.
Teja, can you come? I request Hari to come onto the dais. Niharika, can we have on your stage? Venkat Sai. Ashray. Mm-hmm. So we have the participants who are in online. So Tarun Sai, I request Erica to present the certificate on screen.
Hi, sorry. So, can you unmute and turn your video on, and you can say a few words.
Yeah, it was an amazing experience. Thank you so much, especially Erica. You worked so hard and you gave me a lot of insights. And Srikant sir also, he even went out and filled a lot of forms for me. So that was quite good. Thank you so much.
Okay, next.
Asad Ahmad.
Asad, can you also unmute and video? Perfect. Yeah. Give me a second. Perfect. Go ahead.
Thank you, Rotation Program, Erica, and everyone for helping us out through the entire journey. We have gone through greatly insightful workshops and come up with a good project. Hopefully we'll be continuing it further and see how it goes. Thank you, everyone.
Next, Faizan Ali.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Rotu Shrine, for providing this opportunity. Thank you, Erica, and other members as well for putting so much effort into it. Those were some really grateful comments and insights, and we shall be continuing with the comments that you all made. We'll try to upgrade it into a further level. Thank you so much.
So last, Abhijit Girin.
Hello.
Abhijit, can you unmute yourself?
First of all, hello. Big thanks for the whole crew, like Fumika sir, Hideki sir, Hiromi, Erica, for all your support. You really, this program really made me think a lot human-centrically, and this whole framework was really nice. Really nice. Thank you.
So we have Yashraj.
Yashraj is not here.
Okay.
I think Meet Shah. Okay, I think he's not here also. We can go ahead and finish.
Okay.
We've called everyone from online.
So we are done with the certificate distribution. So I request Naho to come under Dayas. Yes. Request for the goodies presentation for the speaker and our mentor.
Sorry? Okay.
Mr. Gopal, can you come? Mr. Gopal, can we have a picture?
Shall we remove the mask?
I think it's better to remove the mask.
Just keep quiet.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Gopal. So I request Srikant to come up to the dais. Thank you, Srikant. Thank you, Naho. So we have a break for 10 minutes. We will gather here after 10 minutes. So yeah.
So evaluators, please stay back for our discussion. Rest of us can have snacks, which are in cafeteria.
Priyanka, can we have 20 minutes?
Sure. 20 minutes, guys.
Okay, perfect.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Done.
Oh, and also
staying here.
Priyanka, during the break, it would be great if you could get a group picture of everyone at the venue.
Sure, I'll do that. So I was thinking in the end, we can take a picture in the same room.
Okay, sure. Whenever works.
Sure, yeah.
Thank you.
cafeteria is on your left, I think all of you know, right? Nahusan and Shrikant will be back in 2 minutes. They're just sending off the guest. So they'll be coming back. 2 minutes. Okay, now he's here already. We can discuss. You really want to stay here? Thank you.